what it is, right? You're listening to the Trend. Who? Telisa Franklin Show. What we doing over here on the Trend? We're trending the music, the culture, and the conversation. And I'm going to tell you, on today's conversation, is going to be an impactful conversation. Why? When you have two power-packed people in the studio with you today, you know it's going to be H-O-T, baby. It's going to be hot. And on today, I am just so excited about this project that you got to listen. Open up your ears and open up your heart to see, because this is going to be life-changing conversations. They're doing the life-changer work for our young people, because I am just so proud of people that's standing on the front line that is saying, I'm going to do the work for that next generation to be successful. And so let me tell you what's happening today. There is going to be an amazing event. I have two amazing people in the studio with me. So I think I'm going to just dive in this conversation, y'all, so that y'all can hear what I know, so everybody can know. So go ahead and tell your friend, tell your everybody, go ahead and text them. If you're watching it on social media, share this live. If you're riding down the car, go ahead and call somebody and say, you got to turn it on FM 104, AM 1240. What? Because Telisa's really trending today, y'all. She really got it going on. So then you welcome to the Telisa Franklin Show, my dear friend, and we've been probably friends for 20 years, because doing the work of our community is none other than Melvin Burgess. Hello there, honey.
Hello.
How are you?
Doing fine.
Good, good. And then, y'all, I have my new sister. She's so beautiful. So if you're driving down the road, you can't see what I see, but you need to go. When you get to social media, you'll see she's beautiful on the inside and out. Will you welcome with us Mrs. Adriana Vestal? Hello there.
Hello. Thank you so much, Ms. Franklin. And thank you so much for the service that you are doing for our community.
Hey, I tell everybody, I love my community. For so long, because I go back to Melvin and I, we've been doing community work for the people for so many years, and it just makes my heart feel good to see that we ain't tired yet. As old say said, we ain't tired yet, right?
That's right.
And Melvin, so kind of tell us, why are you continuing to do the work that you do in our community?
Well, Telisa, I just still feel that even though the work that we were doing together, I was on the county commission, as well as other positions, is that there's a need. You know, we see what's happening every day, and we hear people talking about our youth. We hear people talking about what the cause is. But the cause is that we got to dive in, and we need to continue to do the work with fidelity. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm still committed to doing the work. You know, I love Memphis. This is my city. And of course, you know, retiring from the school system as the chief internal auditor, I'm still with kids. I still feel that the kids are the answer. And yeah, there are a lot of issues that we have, just like other cities. However, I feel that there is an initiative that I'm involved with. I feel that can change the trajectory of where our kids can be, because we still have great students out here. And the negative has always been on, you know, kids and, you know, what they're doing in schools. But there's never been a push for these kids who are doing the right thing, as well as getting good grades and being where they're supposed to be. So we just want to ensure with an initiative that we'll be talking about that they are at the table and they do have the resources to make it and get some of these jobs that that they are qualified to do. Or we're going to make sure that they are at the table when Blue Oval comes here, or they're already here, or get them aligned. But a lot of students, they have the grades, they have the know-how, they're doing well in school, but some just don't know and just don't have the resources. So we just want to make sure that we lay that track out for those students.
I love it. And I love what you're doing. And Adriana, kind of tell us, what's your part in this? And then we're going to talk about the Boule and all the good things that's happening. Because listen, y'all, save the date. Next Saturday, September 23rd, is going to be something grand that's happening right here in our city. So kind of tell us why you're doing what you're doing with this organization.
Well, I help the Sigma Pi Phi fraternity, Delta Boule, with their social action outreach. There's a lot to be done here in the city of Memphis. And our biggest goal is we want to prepare and position our students. Now we're talking about STEMs. So we want to prepare and position our students for STEM degrees and STEM careers and those STEM opportunities.
Yeah. And you definitely said opportunities, because when people talk about, oh, Blue Oval's coming, Blue Oval's coming, it's one thing for them to come, and it's another for children, especially children of color, to be prepared to walk in those opportunities that can not only change their life but changed your whole family financial life. And so kind of talk about when we talk, I'm telling people to save the day for next week for the Boulé. Kind of tell us, what is the Boulé?
Well, I don't want to get too far into that, but basically, it was here to contribute to enhancement of underserved communities. That's the major focus of the organization, to make sure that there's a level playing field and that we want to address systemic inequities in the Black communities. We want to make them aware of what's going on, but how can we help for those communities that are underserved?
Mm-hmm. And we know that in Memphis, it's just not one zip code that's underprivileged and underserved. Right. We have multiple zip codes that are, and whether you want to believe it or not, but now it's coming to the forefront. There's so many disparities that is in our communities. And that's why it is imperative that I feel that you, I, and everybody, we zone together and say, how can we help these communities? Because I'm always a witness to say, I was one of those young people that was in one of those disparities, and somebody reached back. And this is not anything negative, but this is just the truth. The person that reached back and showed me was somebody that didn't look like me, right? And so I'm committed to making sure that somebody look like them say, I'm going to be here to help you. And so, Melvin, kind of talk about that piece, because sure. You know it firsthand. You know, we've been on the boots on the ground.
That's right.
And we've been in places and sitting at tables so that we are at these tables to be a voice for those voices, but to let them know that, hey, these young people matter. So kind of tell us a little bit.
So just to add to what we talked about earlier, you know, the initiative is called the Parity Project. And this Sigma Pi Phi's fraternity-wide call to action to level the playing field, you know, by achieving parity for Black America by the year 2030. The initiative is a major undertaking to promote highly compensated STEM-related career opportunities to Black high school students and early career professionals. The goal of the Parity Project is to tackle the wealth disparity and accelerate the achievement of economic parity in Black America through greater representation in lucrative STEM fields. So you're going to hear a lot of that being said at the summit, which is going to be on the 23rd from 10 to 1 at the Civil Rights Museum. And we're bringing all of our partners. That stands, we got the
Greater Chamber.
Okay.
We've partnered with Memphis Shelby County Schools. Our keynote will be from Dr. Angela Whitelaw. She is the Deputy Superintendent of Academic Schools and Support. And we've partnered with a host of STEM companies, the University of Memphis, they will be on our panel talking about engineering and how that fits into the broader picture of STEMs and how we can use engineering to leverage those skills to make an impact, a positive impact on our society.
And that's true. That's true.
I think to add to that, I want people to know we're going to have people here locally. We're going to have Mrs. Dana Porner, who is the CEO of Preserver Partners, which is a financial investment firm. Also, we're going to have Jeremy Simpson with Systems Technology. We're going to have others, Michael Hooks, who's with All World. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have, you know, people here in Memphis that look just like us that will be part of this panel to see what they do and some of the STEM careers that they have. So I'm really excited about ones we've chosen to be on the panel that are right here in our own backyard.
Yeah, because I love that you make sure we have the people that some of these young people may bump into the grocery store. They may bump into in church service. Like, man, I know you. Can you really help me do this and do that? So I love that piece. And so let's even talk about how is Boulé relevant today nationally and locally? Because you talked about the STEM event, but how is the Boulé? Because it's all pulling back to what the mission of what they have.
Right. So, you know, we know that all students, you know, will probably not be a part of STEMs, but at least we can educate them to where they want to go. Mm-hmm. One thing that we're doing that we're working with Lamont, LOC 807.
Yes.
That we're working with, and we have about 30 students so far. And one of our members was instrumental in connecting us with one of the students over there named Kashana Williams, who have already graduated, but she wanted to make sure she come back and give back to these students who are trying to get on track or try to make sure they make it through. We got to understand that these kids, a lot of these kids are just first-time kids or first-time college-educated kids, and they don't have the resource or they don't know the resources, you know, out there to keep moving on. Well, we have provided an internship for about 30 of those students. And we want to make sure that the word, Telisa, is we're going to sponsor them, meaning that we're working with them now. We're going to make sure that they go through, you know, what their career field. We want to make sure they have a job when they come out of it.
Yes.
So that's going to be the key. We want to sponsor these kids. And as of now, the group has grown from like 20 to 30 and is steady moving. I think Thursday before last, we had a mixer and clothes closet. They told us that they needed clothes to interview in. So a lot of our members stepped up and provided a lot of clothes and over $3,000 worth of gift cards for students who want to buy, you know, for them to buy clothes to go and interview in. And the good thing is we've hired a talent coach to help them with their interview skills, to help them with their resumes,
professional development.
So we want to make sure these kids, you know, that's the other side of it, because we still know there's a need for these students at Lemoyne, and we love these kids. Matter of fact, I took one of the kids with me to the football game over the weekend.
Oh, wow. That was nice.
Very excited because he had never been up in the stadium club. But those are things, you know, just that we're going to have to do. I get tired of people talking about it starts at home. I get tired of people talking about, you know, well, this and that, that and this. But we got to pull our sleeves up and go to work, you know, where it's needed. And it shouldn't be a reason why in the world our own HBCU in our city right next door should be hurting for anything when it comes to resources. So we're committed to that.
So true. And just like you heard, they're committed. We all as Memphians right here in the Bluff City, we got to be for real committed to seeing the success because HBCU, many of those children there, they are going through. They all have some challenges. And if all of us work together, we can see things better. And then we'll, for me, I see that when we work together, we can you know, keep those children from having a dropout rate or keep them kids from making decisions. Well, I got to go work at McDonald's or I got to go do this so I can't go in school. But if we help them, they may own the next McDonald's, right?
Absolutely.
And so we can give those opportunities. And I just love what you guys are doing. And I'm just so proud of it. I can't wait to even share more on the air of what you all are doing over LOC, because I love LOC. So let's go back to you, Adriana, about this parity project, that how critical it is for Memphis, right? Yes. Because we can see what's going on all over the media and all over the news, but we're in Memphis.
Yes.
How critical for our success to have this this project?
It's extremely critical, not only for our now, but for our future. We know that Memphis recently became the largest majority minority city.
Mm-hmm.
So not only that, we also have high poverty and high crime rate. Well, what we want to do is with our parity project is start giving our children a solution. We know that African Americans, we only make up a small percentage of the population. It's 13.4% of the population. But when we're looking at poverty levels, 25% of our community live either at or below poverty. That is a disparity.
Yes.
When we're looking at the prison populations, we make up almost 40%. That is a disparity. However, on the other side, when we're looking at those industries that build wealth, STEMs, private equity, Fortune 500 corporate boards, we only make up a small percent. So we want to be deliberate. We want to be intentional about creating a pathway. And we believe that STEMs is a viable pathway to parity. So that's the theme for our summit. Instead of that school to prison pipeline, we're going to do school to STEM pipeline, producing a path to parity.
So when you said STEM, because many, we have some parents and grandparents, some older generation probably don't really fully understand. You hear people say STEM, but they may not really know. So kind of tell us in depth, in your words, in layman's term, what is STEM? How is STEM being used even in today, so people can relate to, okay, I understand now. Help us.
Well, traditionally, STEM is science, technology, engineering, and math. And, you know, most people, they think, well, I don't want to be an engineer. But when we're looking at that technology component, technology has evened the playing field. Everyone engages in technology. Mm-hmm. If you use your phone, you're engaging in technology. So what we want to do is, we want to teach our children, our community, how to be disruptors, because that's what STEM is about.
Mm-hmm.
STEM is about using technology to solve an issue. And so part of the Parity Project is teaching our students how to be critical thinkers, how to be like Netflix, how mm-hmm. to do what Netflix did to Blockbuster, how to become that next Uber. And so that's why it's very, very critical that we start having these conversations. We start talking about, okay, well, what are some of the obstacles? Because there are some academic obstacles locally, but what can we do? It can be something simple as when you have a toddler, letting your toddler engage with Legos, because Legos help build your math skills. Mm-hmm. And math is the foundation for sense.
Wow. So y'all know, every grandparent, you know what you're getting your children for Christmas, right? Some Legos.
Some Legos.
And that means so much. So because when you think about that and you're saying about the Black students from the early career, so why should Black students or early career professionals be concerned about this parity event? Because sometimes I think, Melvin, that when we've made it, we forget that we need to make sure we help somebody else. But as I know, as I go to bed and get up every morning, I'm getting a little bit older, right? I'm not getting any younger. And I want somebody baby, to still continue this torch and continue this fire that I'm trying to put in our community. So why is this so important, Melvin?
One thing I learned, Telisa, is that remember this, you know, if you don't see it, you can't dream it.
Mm.
Right. And I don't think, you know, a lot of our African-Americans who have made it and moved on, I don't think it's so much that they have forgotten. It's about, it's just not being mentioned, or they're not in the trajectory of like what's the work that's going on.
Yeah.
So how do we put that out there to where they can get involved? You know, maybe they don't have the time, but guess what? They can give financially to help us get where we got to go.
Right.
So I think it's more of that, because I've been dealing with a lot of people, you know, who want to give, who's given to the STEM Summit. You know, this is just not the first one we want to do. We want to continue doing this summit to see where we are. And if we're moving the needle,
yeah,
because what we found out is we're working in silos when it comes to STEMs. Everybody's doing something. You got Girls Inc., AKA's doing something, the Kappa's Guy Right program. Just everybody's doing something, but you know, we're not discouraging that. We all want to all come together and see how we can help each other in this STEMs initiative to where we can really make a difference. But my dream is to one day have an innovation center here in Shelby County to where all these STEM students are in this innovation center. We know who they are. We know how we can help them, and we can ship them out to these great jobs.
Yeah.
They already doing this on the West Coast. Mrs. Vestal has been talking with a lady on the West Coast. They've already doing this. And it is a great initiative. And I think that's where we can start. We talk about, we want to do things that are just a great city with our students and our kids. This is where it's going to happen. This is the next generation, STEM jobs, and just, you know, working together with students. But we really need also African-American men. We need mentors. We need mentors for these young men, you know, so they can see you. Because someone told us, and I didn't believe it, that there's not a lot of Black men on Lamont on campuses, right? So, if you can, try to get over there and just show your face and talk to these young men. And it shouldn't be any reason in the world why Lemoyne should not have what they need. But I know we're committed, the Boulay is committed to making sure that they have all the resources they need to get where they have to be, through education.
And I love that you guys are committed, because you are African-American men. They are African-American men that is truly engaged to seeing the next African young boy become that man and be fruitful in their society. And so let me tell y'all, men that's out here, you know, we used to always say, the Army say they want a good man. Listen, these other young boys need a good man in their life just to show them some things that we can't show them, right?
Yes.
You know, I'm always reminded, because I'm blessed with a son. And now, at first I was like, oh, I can show my boy everything, right? But there are some things that only his dad has shown him. And I'd be like, where you learn that from? And I learned that it's those, he's like, Ma, dad got some wisdom. I'm like, your dad got some wisdom, what?
Absolutely.
You know, but that means so much to me. And then not only that, my boy has his uncles as all they're seeing, but there are some young boys that's on campus that don't have that, right? They don't have those young men and those older men that can speak wisdom into their life and say, listen, you know what? And even if you've made some errors in life, you're listening to me, listen, share those with those young men and say, going down this path, hanging with this set of friends will lead you to this path. By the grace of God, I brought it back. Yes. But many times they don't get it. I don't know if you've witnessed that, Melvin, before.
I have. And Telisa, the biggest problem we've had is, and I know when I've, as the assessor role that I have, of course, you know, I was doing the work in Orange Mound. And now I see, of course, we're in the voting stage of getting a new mayor. And this is what I suggest. Until we invest back in our communities, you know, to where we got good schools, we got all the resources we need, because that's what has happened. Our community has broke apart. Yeah. So there are no more next door neighbors who work for the fire department. There are no more next door neighbors who were once teachers, all of that. It's all scattered out. We don't have any villages anymore. Mm. So our kids don't see that. This is who I want to be like. When I was growing up as a kid in Memphis, in our neighborhood, basically, we used to say, I want to be like Larry Finch, or Dr. K. And these were our own. And we weren't talking about being like Michael Jordan or Magic Johnson, because you know what? We saw these people right next door in our own community. And that's what I think that can make Memphis a better Memphis, is reinvesting back in the oldest municipality in the county, and that is Memphis.
Yes.
Invest back in Memphis. Everybody wants the same things. We want good schools. We want resources. We want what, like everybody else has.
Yeah.
Until we reinvest back in the oldest infrastructure, we're going to always be where we are.
Absolutely. I totally agree. We have to, you know, the night before, we did a town hall in the Douglas community. And it, for me, it was about how can we reinvest and support what we have right here. We can't keep looking at other communities if we've never really fully invested in the good of our community. And we all work together, hand in hand. And I love what you all are doing. Y'all brought in power players, as I call, to everybody to work together, where it's no competition. It's all about us completing each other for the goodness of our community.
Absolutely. You know, there's an old African proverb that says, if you want to go faster, go alone. But if you want to go farther, you got to go together.
Yes. And we're just trying to make this thing together. Because, you know, one thing I'm hearing, I probably in every conversation, right, in every room, oh, Blue Oak was coming. I'm like, I get that. But let's talk about how we really positioning our children that maybe didn't come from those families that's moving from out of town. Because let's be real, real estate closer to those communities are like an all-time high, because you got people coming from other areas because they're ready and equipped. And so what I'm hearing you all are doing, y'all ready to equip our own to go get those great paying jobs that's above what they call livable wages. Yes. And so they can literally start seeing themselves out of poverty and into another place. It's like, Melvin, don't tell me he's ready. Come on, Melvin, because you're ready to say something.
Well, we just want our kids to have a pathway.
Yeah.
You know, just like my girls did. You know, I got two girls, both graduated from Spelman. I got one's a senior, thank God. But one lives in New York and one lives in Atlanta, and they don't even want to come back home, right? So how do we keep our best and our talented here? And that's how we do it, you know, by offering them jobs, because when they come back, there are jobs, but in a lot of these jobs, you got to know someone.
Yeah.
It's just that simple.
Yeah.
You know, and let's just be real about that. Regardless of your education, you have to know someone. So it should be an even playing field for our students who want to come back, who have the pathway. So all we want to do is in this summit is we all come together as one. Everybody keep doing what they're doing, and let's make this thing meaningful, because I'm not in it just to waste my time. I wouldn't even be here.
Yeah,
I'm not going to waste my time if I feel it's not working. And by the grace of God, we got someone here, Ms. Vessel, who's helping us, who's guiding the ship for us, to make this a meaningful initiative. And it can be, we got someone coming down at the grand level who's really taking notes on how we're doing it. And we're basically going to be the front leaders. This is the first one that's ever been done with this initiative, because it didn't really get off the ground well because of COVID.
Mm-hmm.
So everything was virtual.
Yeah.
So now we're touching each other now. So we're kind of, I don't know, we're the first, but we're out there, you know, as far as the Parity Project Base 11. Now, the Base 11 is the 501c3 that was implemented by one of our own. And he was like, hey, look, you know, it was for other students also.
BIPOC, Black and Indigenous people of color, but it was on the West Coast.
Okay.
So it's a fully functioning STEM company.
Wow.
And a lot of these members are at the table, and we're saying, hey, bring these students to the table, you know, with their talents, and let's make this thing work. So we just make sure that we got a hub here of talented students, and we can put you out there and put you where you need to go.
Yeah. And we have people of color in leadership. And I think the most critical thing is using your leverage, using your influence to bring others to the table, mm-hmm. because there's an agenda at the table.
Yes.
And unfortunately, we're on it. Mm-hmm. Therefore, we need to be represented at the table.
Yeah. Yeah. And you said something that making sure the level of at the table, but the influence. And then Melvin said it's about in Memphis about who, you know, because we do see that many of our people, our children go off to college and it's hard to get them to come back home. Right. You know, it was like tooth and nail for me to get my boy to come back mm-hmm. home. And let's be honest, he graduated from Valley and he decided to wanted to stay in Mississippi, right? I was like, baby, I want my baby at home. Bring the baby home, right? But it was just a thing. You have to really give them something. And him coming home with master's degrees and all this, and he's like, sus, I don't need your help, right? But then he was like, I was like, baby, I think you do need my help, right? Yeah. Because it's about who you know and who knows you, right? And relationships. Yeah. And now I see life is doing, he's back in Memphis. But we got to make sure that we're preparing our children when they leave from Memphis. We want our kids to come back home, but we got to have something at home for them to come back to that's really going to help push the needle in their life. And Melvin, you said something, the level of influence is always key. And so when these young people come to this STEM summit on next Saturday, they're going to get an opportunity to shake hands, rub elbows, exchange social media with those influencers that can literally open up a door for them, maybe for an internship or maybe for whatever it may be. But now they have some relationships, because how for me, I know relationships are everything to me, right? Everything I think the Lord has given me is because it was great relationships. How critical are we teaching about relationships with this summit?
Well, there will be some networking opportunities with our speakers and our panelists. We will have vendors there for our sponsors. And like you mentioned earlier, it's about being able to rub elbows with those change agents. Our summit will be moderated by Kanji Anthony.
Yes.
And she was at the height of her media career and left that to start a technology company.
Yes.
Which was, absolutely.
Yes.
And we will have someone from the chamber.
Okay.
And so they're the gatekeepers to all of the businesses here. So there will be networking opportunities at our STEM summit.
Yeah. Melvin, go ahead. And then I want you to give some, because you the king and networking. Melvin can work a room.
But yes.
They say I can talk. No, Melvin can work a room. The room can be a 10,000 square feet place. He gonna work it from one to the other. He understands it.
And Melvin, he likes to connect people.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So Melvin, kind of talk about that and give us some networking tips on how somebody can work the room like a Melvin Burgess. Because you got that thing. I watch you in action. I can be on the opposite side of the room. I say, I ain't got to worry about it because Melvin going to make his way over here.
Yeah. Well, you know, first, before I answer that, Telisa, I want to just say, I want to really give the chamber kudos to Amity Schuler. She has been really, really helpful in guiding us and what we need and just connecting with us. And I think the chamber, we were on a call that Ms. Adrienne set up with our folks. And they were, you know, she was talking about Blue Oval and they were just so excited of, you know, what's coming to Stanton, Tennessee, which could be very impactful here in Memphis. But it appears that, you know, they were looking for someone, an initiative like what we brought to the table. Everybody was just so excited. But I really want to give my hats off to Amity Schuler and also to Bobby White over at the chamber for really helping us and guiding us with that initiative. But as far as the networking thing, that's in my blood. You know, my dad, and I, of course, you know, and I like to run my mouth. And I just like, I like helping people. And even where I am now, you know, I'm very customer oriented. I take that very serious because I feel that that's something that we don't do or we haven't done well as elected officials and letting our constituents know, you know, what resources that they have. And people need to know what's out there, you know, where they can grab. There's a lot of things that people didn't even know about my office, where I am now, you know, so it's up to us to network with these people. Say, hey, how can I help you? Take my card. I'm not just saying going over there doing a career date and that's it. You don't see you anymore. No, it has to be bigger and better than that. You know, a show is one thing, but a do is another.
Come on.
So we just got to start doing, you know, I know like they say that it's a lot of fruit to be harvested, but few laborers, but we got to step in. Yes. If we want to see a change in our kids, how do you think I feel with two girls, you know, who are educated and, you know, and it's like, okay, well, do you have a boyfriend or, you know, I mean, what's going to happen here? It's not looking good. And I'm tired of hearing people saying, well, it starts from home. this and that and this. But one thing I could say that I've heard is that, you know, until we all as a city realize no matter what programs you put together, no matter what deterrent you put from going down on Beale Street, blocking streets, you know, and they talk about the word rehabilitation, right? Until you rehabilitate somebody's heart, and the only way we can do this is through the church, I think we're going to always be at square one. So I think, mm-hmm. you know, that's something that we really need to look at, how we get these kids involved or families back involved, you know, with faith. So, but the networking thing, that's just how I believe in, you know, getting the word out.
Yeah. And, you know, two things, we got to get people back to that higher power, and the higher power for my higher power is Jesus, right?
Right. Jesus.
And we got to have that. Right. And then from the networking and talking, I was told that I could talk to a tree and then talk back. I said, it do.
Yes,
don't you see the leaves?
I've seen you in action.
Too. Don't you see the leaves?
I've seen you in action. Yeah. Talisa, I've seen you in action.
I know the talk.
I know it.
I want to hear people's stories, right?
That's right.
You got to want to hear people's story, because everybody got a story. Everybody should feel valued. Everybody should feel appreciated. And I just feel like, why shouldn't I make them feel good that day, right?
That's
because
right.
even when I'm having a bad day, if you listen to somebody else's, their day could be really, really bad. And you're like, man, I walk in the park. I ain't got what you got, right?
That's right.
And so that's why it's critical. And then when you said that having your faith and getting back to the church, you know, a lot of people have used, because of COVID, they don't want to go back in the building. They want to get they want to do everything virtual. And I love virtual, but I believe you get a greater impact when you go into the church. And for one thing, you get to be with your brothers and your sisters.
Mm-hmm.
You get that fellowship. For most of you don't know who you're going to meet in a church that's going to change your life. You ain't going to meet them on social media, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's make sure we get back in, and then we can be able to see what our needs are. And so that if you're in the church, I'm like, you know what? So you need a job. I just heard somebody said they had an opening. Let me see what I can do for you. You missed that piece, right? You missed that networking piece. And we just got to get back to it.
That's right.
You know, and so I'm telling you all, your pastors and your leaders, let's create an atmosphere for people to say, I got to get back into the church. I got to get back into fellowship. And then we got to get back in and get to serving.
Yes.
Right.
Not just go back in just to have serve this.
That's right.
But let's get back into the serving others. Because there is some young people that's in your community that needs you. There are some young people in your community needs to know that if I'm going through, if I'm homeless or if I'm without, my church can help me through this process to get me over, right?
That's right.
Because that's what we have to do. And I just love just circling back to what Assessor you've said in every role I've seen you just really, truly serve the people, right? And so I know with you being at the table of this great event, we know service of the people is at the table.
That's right.
That means something
to me, right? That's right.
That means something to me.
That's right.
You just can't be at the table and be salad, because I ain't no salad girl.
Okay.
Okay. And so as we wrap it up, because I know we'll have a great time just having conversation, but let's circle back to this big event that's happening next week, September the 23rd, 2023, National Civil Rights Museum. Talk us through that day, what it looks like, what time it starts, how our speakers is going to be lined up, because then maybe somebody will say, Lisa, I already got something planned that day. Well, maybe you need to still take some time to get your child, because now it's not even so much about us. It's about our young people. Or you may say, let me go get this young girl in my church or this young guy in my church. His mom may not know much. They may be coming from a challenge home. Let me invest 3 or 4 hours in them and say, I'm going to take them to this summit so I can say that I was a light in their darkness, to say, I'm going to help take you to the light of what it looks like of a new career that can change your life. So tell us from the itinerary, from getting up that morning to going down.
Amen. Well, our summit, it is a STEM summit. Okay. And, you know, I do want to say that I don't have a STEM background, but I'm a STEM champion. I see where STEM is going and I want to be a part of it. So even if you aren't in STEMs, but you're STEM curious, this is an opportunity for you to come and learn and find out more about STEMs. So our event starts at 10. It's from 10 until 1, but registration begins at 9:30, because we will begin at 10 a.m. prompt, because it is Saturday and we don't want to hold you all day. So registration starts at 9:30. Our summit begins at 10. We will have speakers from our parody project. We will have a speaker from our Base 11 partnership. We will have a speaker from the summit. And then we will have our keynote address from Memphis Shelby County Schools Deputy Superintendent, Dr. Angela Whitelaw. And then we will have two panel discussions. Our first panel will talk about the academic obstacles, the requirements for you to be successful in getting your STEM degree. And our B panel will talk about those STEM careers and those opportunities. And how do we get connected in those careers? How do we get acclimated in those careers? What's needed in those careers? And then we will provide lunch. Lunch is provided at the end of our summit. And I just want to let everyone know, this is a free community event.
And I was just going to ask that, what is the cost for this? And it just done got really, really, really good, right?
Just your time.
Wow. Do they need to pre-register? I know you said registration is that morning, but do you need to pre-register so you can have an idea?
Yes, you can. We have a flyer that's out there. We got it on the, I think we got one piece on the social media, and
we have a flyer on the HBCU Awareness Foundation.
And also, if you're watching this on social media, I'm dropping it in the chat as soon as we get through today. So don't worry about that. I'll drop that. And if you are riding, all you have to do is call our office, 901-295-9223. Call our office, and we'd be more than happy to give you that information. Or just follow your girl, Telisa Franklin. You know I'm going to post it on my page, but you're right. So we're going to make sure we do that. So I got that on that too.
Thank
so you have to put it all in your head.
And so there is a QR code where you can register, because we are feeding people and we just kind of want to know the ballpark.
Yeah, so we won't run out of food, because we know it's going to be a whole lot of people there to get this great knowledge.
Yes.
I love it.
Thank you, Telisa.
Oh, thank you. So again, y'all, next Saturday, September the 23rd, you know all roads leading to where? The neighbor, National Civil Rights Museum. For this summit, it's going to be an amazing power pack. As we're wrapping up, Assessor Melvin Burgess. Melvin Burgess, my dear friend, give us your last words and how people can stay connected to you. Because I know you got this big thing going, but you're always doing so many great things in our community. And we need people to stay connected to greatness.
Thanks to Lisa. A lot of things we're doing. I have a Facebook page for the assessor's office as far as, and as well as other communications you will get in the mail. We want to just stay continue connected, you know, with our constituents to make sure that they got what they need and they understand about, you know, what's going on in the appraisal field. I know a lot of people concerned about their assessments went up on their homes, you know, throughout this last reappraisal that was done. But it's going to get a little bit better. But the market is better as a seller's market. And, you know, we want our assessments to be where they need to be, especially in our communities where they are just it's hurting, like in your Klondikes and your New Chicago. You know, where they need to be up to par. And we want to work hard to make sure that we can put new homes, you know, back on the roll. Because the key is that a lot of these properties you see in these undeserving neighborhoods or these neighborhoods that are having issues that you're paying for that. So until we can get a remedy, working with Jay Hardaway to see how we can get these blighted properties and some of these properties that are in the land bank, get them back on the road and get families in them, you know, so these neighborhoods can be where they need to be, you know, moving forward.
Love it. Thank you so much for all you do.
Thank you for having us.
Give us your lasting words, sweetheart.
I just want to say that in order for Memphis to become what we wanted to become, we are going to have to start building a legacy of faith, which is what we talked about earlier, and service to one another. And if we stay committed to those two principles, I am positive and I'm confident that Memphis will be all that God designed Memphis to be.
Yes. Y'all, she said something. Y'all know faith and service. I love it. Thank you so much, sister,
for being here.
I appreciate you. Thank you, my brother, for being
always here. Always. Listen, like anything, you know that.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
All right. Know that you're all listening and you're watching. Know that I love you, baby. Absolutely, positively love you. And there's nothing you can do about it. Make this day, make this moment, make this second the best ever, and learn how to be the best version of you, because everybody else is already taken. Keep it locked right here to the trend. I am Telisa Franklin.